Hello again folks, Martin Lehner here from Tangerine Technology, and in this video I am going to talk about the certification for disaster recovery engineer. So if you watch my previous videos, I have talked about other certifications I've done. Namely, I did a review on this one, CPTE, Certified Penetration Testing Engineer, from Mile 2. Mile 2 is the company that puts these on. I'm a huge fan of Mile 2. Full disclosure here, I am not paid by Mile 2. I'm not compensated. I don't get any free training, nothing like that. I have paid money for training, quite a bit of money for training from these guys. And I think they put on really, really good courses. The certifications are nice. They're all pretty much security related in one way or another. They don't do things like the MCSE, where you learn about server, or they don't do things like you learn how to code, or you learn HTML or things like that. They focus a lot on not so much the practical, in terms of, you know, this is how you use this piece of software here. Now you're certified in that piece of software. It's not like VMware training, where now you know how to use vSphere, right? It's not like that. It's very high level. It's, for example, in the penetration testing engineer course, they talk about various ways that you can penetrate networks, various ways you can test a network. Certainly we have examples with software and different tools, but it's not like a certification for those specific tools. It's more of a generality. And that's what I really like about their courses, to be honest. I have done courses where I've been certified in very specific things. The problem with those is you spend time, you spend money, and then you know that specific thing. If you go and certify yourself in Windows Server 2003, that is now obsolete. That was obsolete a long time ago. But that's the thing. You pay money to certify in that, and then that is what you know. You do kind of more of these generalities where you understand the concepts, then you can apply the correct tools of the time, what's available, right? You know, a decade ago, cloud backup wasn't really something that was generally offered, or not at least used mainstream as a backup tool. Now for disaster recovery, cloud backup is something that exists. You know, now you see things like cloud backups of VMs, where you can spin up a VM in the cloud if your physical infrastructure gets destroyed by flood, fire, whatever. So those are really things, again, if you certify in those specific tools and areas there, then that's what you know. When something new is released 12 months down the road, 18 months down the road, whatever. And again, remember, this is the technology in industry. It changes really, really fast, right? Something you learn now isn't going to be relevant in a decade. It's just not. So in that sense, I prefer training and certification in something that's more of a generality. More of a concept. That's my personal thoughts on it. Anyway, so we move on. So before, this I'm going to do this review on Certified Disaster Recovery Engineer, CDRE, again, from Mile 2. And I'll just give you a quick overview of the course and what I thought about it. I took this course back in, 2014 or 2015. I think it was the end of 2014 that I took this course. It's a great course. It's the last one that I did before the penetration testing, and yeah, I mean, this course, if I remember correctly, this was a 4-day course, 3 or 4-day course, delivered virtually, so virtual classroom. So I was logged in with the instructor. This particular one had an instructor that was based out of Florida, really, really good instructor. She was really good. And basically, it teaches you a lot about disaster recovery. Again, it doesn't teach you necessarily, you know, you have to use this backup software. You must use Windows Server Backup. You must use Macrium, Backup for All, whatever. It doesn't actually teach you that. It doesn't teach you how to do the backup. If that's what you're looking for, this is not for you. What this is the concept of disaster recovery. So it starts, for example, with a BIA, a business impact assessment. So basically what this is you look at your systems, okay? What do we do on our systems? Do the salespeople use our systems? Do the customer service people use our systems? Who uses them? and you start looking at it. So you take your company, the organization you're working for, whatever, and you take all the systems that are used, all the computer systems that are used, and you say, okay, here's what they're used for, here's who uses them. Now we need to look at what is the impact to the business if these systems go down. If all the systems go down, if some of the systems go down, and this is what you do, is you go through and you look at what the impact is. For businesses, the number one thing is obviously what's the financial impact? What will this cost the company? If this system, if the sales system goes down that houses all the website orders or whatever, how much will this cost per hour, per day, per week that it is down? Based on that, that's how you determine what level of disaster recovery you need to be able to provide, what kind of backups you have. If the cost of being down is $100 a week, you're not going to implement a $20,000 backup regime because it's not worth it, right? The impact of being down and the risk of being down is not greater than the cost of having a backup running, right? And that's what the BIA does. It lets you figure out what those costs are and figure out if it makes sense to invest in the backup infrastructure. So this is one of those things. For example, let's just take an example, and will be an example from what I do. So as you guys may or may not know, Tangerine Technology is a third-party IT services provider, also known as managed services provider. So we provide third-party IT services to clients. Those are governments, those are businesses, nonprofits, NGOs, basically anybody. And what we do, part of what we do, of course, is backup, right? We manage backups for systems for clients. As part of those backups, one of the things we look at is what is the business, what size of the business, what's the size of the organization, and what can they afford for downtime? So, I mean, as for example, we have one client. They do image level backups, so server image level backups onto external removable media. Okay, so they take these images, get written to an external hard drive, and then those are swapped out, right? If that client goes down, this particular client that I'm thinking of, if they go down, we have, and I'll get into this also, is doing some tests on your backup. So through tests, I know if this client goes down, it's gonna take about 14 hours to recover, okay? So if we have to recover from that backup, it will take about 14 hours until we are in a position where we are back up and running and they're functioning. For this particular business, that is acceptable, right? For the cost of doing those backups and the cost of ensuring they're working and all that stuff, that is acceptable for them. If they are down 14 hours, that's okay. They can make do. We have another client who happens to be a government, a regional government. For them, and because of what they deliver and because of the size of the employee base they have, they can't be down for 14 hours. So for them, we do, in their particular case, we do virtual machine snapshots, backups of virtual machines. This reduces the recovery, and it depends on the system, but on average, it's about a 2-hour recovery for them. That's more acceptable. That's what they require, even though it costs more. There's a higher cost to being able to do those virtual machine snapshots than there is to doing just the system image onto external media. So based on that and based on their need justifies the higher cost of doing those virtual machine snapshots. So that's that. What else is part of this course? We talk about risk, risk analysis. That's part of, so overall we talk about a business continuity policy. So business continuity policy, BCP, that is where you look at how do we continue to function as a business if we have a disaster, if something happens. If the place burns down or we get some malware that crypto locks everything, how do we continue operating the business? Again, if you have one computer and all you do is email and everything else is by hand, your business continuity is pretty simple. You continue to take orders by hand in your order book and you have your carbon copy and all that stuff. It's not a big deal. But if everything you do is electronic, if you're a medical clinic that has all their patient records in electronic form, that's hard to continue doing business when those systems aren't available. So that's part of the business continuity plan. Part of the business continuity plan is doing that business impact analysis. Right? So as part of the business continuity plan, you look at recovery time, you look at cost, you look at all that stuff. And that's where you really create those plans, right? You create those plans and you figure out what makes sense. IT recovery strategies. We go through IT recovery strategies in this course, and that's where we start going through, do you do tape backup, external hard drive, cloud, how do you deal with duplication, that kind of stuff. Implementation, this is where you look at resources throughout the company. Who do you need? If you have a disaster, who will you need, right? And this is one of these things you don't really think about until it actually happens. Do you need to call the CFO? Do you need to call the CEO? Who do you need from the IT team, right? Is there somebody specialized? What happens if they're on vacation? What if they're in the bush and they don't have cellular service? How do you get that person back? In order to achieve your disaster recovery objectives, your timeframes, you need to have the resources. And if those resources aren't available, what do you do? What's your backup plan? So these are things that we look at, right? We look at testing and exercise, and I'll get into that in a minute. Maintenance and updating. So once you create a business impact assessment, once you create a business continuity plan or policy, how often do you update it? Because you do need to update them. Business changes, right? All of a sudden, you know, 5 years down the road, you've moved other key systems in-house or into the cloud, or you've changed from paper to electronic. How does that impact what you assessed before? You need to look at that. We go into cyber attacks a little bit in this course. So we talk about, you know, how cyber attacks happen, where they come from, what the risks are from them, and that kind of thing. They talk about the execution phase of your BCP, your business continuity plan or policy, your business impact assessment, how that works, how you implement it, all that kind of thing. And then really the big one I want to focus on, this is huge for me, is a testing and exercise. This is the biggest thing for us. The biggest thing that I've seen locally within my area is nobody tests backups. They have a backup running, they think it's running, they may even be getting notification that it's running, but nobody's actually tried to recover from it. And the worst thing you can possibly have, I will say as a systems administrator, as an MSP, as a technology professional, the worst thing you can run into is having a backup that you think is working, and then you run into a situation where you need to use it, and then for some reason it doesn't work the way you think it should work. That is the biggest thing, because two things happen there. One, you now have to troubleshoot how to get this data back. Hopefully you can. Even if you can, you have to troubleshoot it. This takes time. Time is something you don't have when you are in a disaster recovery scenario. Everyone needs their systems back ASAP. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter who they are. It doesn't matter if it's a government. It doesn't matter if it's an NGO. It doesn't matter if it's a guy that watches YouTube mostly. Everyone wants their systems back as soon as possible. You don't have time to sit there and play with things and try to figure out how to recover something. You just have to have a process that works, that you know works, that has been tested, that you can follow to do it. For our clients, for most of our clients, I won't say for all, but for the majority of our clients, we are doing biannual or semi-annual. I don't remember which one it is. Semi-annual? Two times a year, we are doing backup recovery tests. So we're doing disaster recovery tests twice a year. We will take whatever medium they're using for backup. We will take it off-site. We will take it into our lab. We will pretend that their entire office burned down to the ground. Nothing is salvageable. Nothing is usable. And we have to get the system back up and running as soon as possible. So I have dedicated equipment on my workbench. I have a dedicated server that all it does is disaster recovery tests. It's ready, it's prepped to go. We plug in whatever media it is or however we are. It depends on the client, of course, the situation, but we will do the recovery test. And we'll use that server that's sitting on the bench. We'll load things back onto it, whatever has to be done, and we will record how long that takes. And when that test is done and we have verified that the system is back up and running, we will make a report. We will write a report. And that report goes to the client, detailed, this is how long it took, this is when we started, this is when we finished, this is when we believe we would have been able to have you up and running again on site, and we present that. So this achieves a few things. One, it makes sure that these backups work. You have to know that your backups work. You have to test them. You cannot accept a notification that just says, yes, the backup worked, as, yes, I have a backup. You need to test them. Two, you need to see if you can recover it with the equipment you have in your lab. It's one thing to have a backup. It's another thing to be able to actually recover that backup on something you have available to you right then and there. So like I said, I have a server that sits in the lab that does absolutely nothing but disaster recovery tests. So if a client has a disaster and we have to recover right away, we can use that server and deploy that server. That server does nothing else. All it does is these tests, and it sits there as a as something that can be used in the event of a disaster. Because if you have something that you know works, you know this backup works, you know that, but you don't know, you know it works, but you don't have the equipment required to actually do the recovery, you'd have to order the equipment, that adds time onto your recovery. So now all of a sudden you have to go and you have to purchase something online. It's got to be shipped to you. Now you've added a day or two or longer in my case. Onto that, it's not a problem of the backup. You know the backup works, you just don't have the equipment to restore that backup. So you have to take that into account. And then it also gives your client an estimated time, right? So if you've been saying for the past 2-3 years, every 6 months you're saying, okay, yeah, it takes about 13 hours to do the recovery. If they experience a disaster and you have to actually move forward with the recovery, now when you go to do it, if they come an hour later and say, hey, is it ready? You can go, remember all those reports we did, it takes about 13 hours. Might be less, might be more, but that's kind of what we're looking at for a time frame. They then understand that. They know, oh yes, you sent me that. I remember always seeing 13 hours. Okay, that's what I'm expecting now. So backup, there's some very important steps and fundamental things you need to do with backups. In order to make sure that they work and that they're usable for you. In the cloud, for example, if you back up into the cloud these days, that's great. How long does it take to download all of that information? If you have 500 gigs in the cloud, 500 gigabytes of data, and you've got a 5 meg internet connection, how long does that take to download? A long time. So that's one of these things. How do you prioritize? Do you get certain data before other data? Does that make sense? So people can work on certain things to start with. Is there a spreadsheet that everybody uses that's the first thing you need to recover? So in what order do you recover? In what order do you download in off of the cloud? These are all things that you have to take a look at, right? These are all things you have to evaluate. And you can't do that if you're not actively testing your backups and doing that. That's a quick overview of the Certified Disaster Recovery Engineer course. Again, I'm certified in this. You can go online on Maltu's website. You can look me up, Martin Lehner, Lehner. If you want to look me up, it'll show you what I'm certified in and when I got the certifications. One of the other certifications I did was CISO, Certified Information Security Officer. I will do a separate video reviewing that course. I thought that course was really, really good too. I learned a lot in that course. But this one was really great as well. In terms of which one was my favorite, I'd probably say Disaster Recovery was my favorite course. I really enjoyed this one. And again, I've looked at other disaster recovery courses, and a lot of them focused specifically on certain tools and applications and that type of thing. This was one of the few that I found that was kind of the generic concept of disaster recovery and how you approach it, which I really appreciated. Again, I really like that method of instruction. Again, we work in an industry where things change so fast. Like, again, cloud backup didn't exist a decade ago, at least not mainstream. So that's completely new, right? Anybody that certified themselves in, I mean, do you guys remember Symantec Backup? What was it called? Backup Now? No. Symantec Backup Exec. Backup Exec with tapes, with magnetic tapes. I mean, that was how you backed things up back in the Windows Server NT 2000, Server 2003 days. Nobody's buying Symantec Backup Exec anymore. So if that's what you know and that's what you were trained in and certified in, great for that time, but it's not useful today. It's completely useless today. That's why I'm not really a fan of this specific stuff. Don't get me wrong, the MCSE, the server path for MCSE, yeah, of course it makes sense. And obviously you have to take what's available in the current market at that time. But again, for these kind of things, security, disaster recovery, penetration testing. These kind of things are more concepts, right? You, as a technology professional, you really need to be fluid in in this industry. You have to be able to adapt to what's going on in the current day, in the current market, in the current environment. Again, a decade ago, CryptoLocker did not exist a decade ago. Ransomware did not exist a decade ago. That's something new, right? You've got to be able to adapt and react to that based on what's going on. As you get better and better in the technology field, you'll be able to start making predictions on what's coming up. Do be careful with making predictions, because sometimes things don't work out the way we all think it's going to. But really, like, it's very forward thinking. It's not reactionary, right? It's not, I shouldn't say reactionary. It's not historical, right? It's not something I learned this 10 years ago, it's the same now. It's really not, right? I mean, if you learn, I'm trying to think of another field. I mean, you know, accounting, for example. Not that accounting doesn't change. Rules change, of course, but the core foundation of accounting, debits, credits, balance sheet, income statement, it doesn't really change much over the years, right? I mean, that is what it is. You don't see, I mean, the balance sheet hasn't changed over the course of a decade or whatever, right? I mean, it's the same as it's always been. That being said, again, this is a fluid industry. It's something you have to be able to adapt in, and it's something that changes all the time. So that's why, again, I'm a huge fan of these courses, because they don't focus on a specific technology or tool. They're very conceptual. I took this one a little bit ago, not a long time ago, but a little bit ago. And I was a real fan of it. Again, Mile 2, I am very happy with Mile 2 in general. I'd like to take more of their courses. They have a health one, actually, that I'd really like to do, a health information, privacy, security type thing. I'd really like to do that one and go from there. So that's basically it for this course. Again, I will do a course on CISO, Certified Information Security Officer. But this was the one on Certified Disaster Recovery Engineer, and that's kind of the overview of the course. Again, very happy with the course. I do recommend it, and I will see you guys at the next video.